Good morning. Thank you so much for tuning in, for joining us. This is the announcements for Sunday, June the 7th. By now, many of you already know that our first Sunday to gather is designated for June the 28th. This will be an outdoor service with outdoor seating, as well as a drive-in service that's taking place at the same time. And this is 3 weeks away. It enables us to prepare for the certain new service format. It helps us to post, gather all the materials and to post what is needed and necessary to comply. It also helps us to prepare the technology involved in this. We are receiving an AM transmitter to be able to transmit a signal. For those that prefer a drive-in format, you can tune in on an AM station for this. And it also helps us to publicize this appropriately and to help you understand what's up ahead, what this might look like, and to inform you with many of the details as possible. And you can look for some video blogs that help explain this even this week. We also want to alert you of the Bow Church that they have received the funds that we collected, and it was sent to them. They have received it. They are now busy about making repairs to the church building and school building, and they are very grateful and thankful for your rich, rich generosity. Thank you so much for your gift and for your giving. We also want to take this time to recognize and honor our graduates. To our 2020 graduates, congratulations for your great accomplishment and for the future that lies ahead. We are deeply disappointed with you that graduation services have been canceled. Certainly it's understandable in light of the times. But in the midst of the sadness and frustration, you know that this in no way dampens your future, because your future is based on God's grace, His goodness, His providence, His faithfulness. And those are character qualities that never get shut down and is never absent. Well, here is a special video presentation for you, the graduates of 2020. Well, we hope you enjoyed the video presentation. We wish to thank A.J. Holtberg, who organized all of the material, put this together, produced this video. He did a great job. Thank you to A.J. Holtberg for doing this. Scripture reading this morning is Psalm 33, verses 8 through 22. Psalm 33, verses 8 to 22. If you want to take the time to turn there, you can and follow along as I read. Let all the people fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. For he spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood firm. The Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples. But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever. The purposes of his heart through all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. From heaven the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place he watches all those who live on the earth. He who forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do. No king is saved by the size of his army. No warrior escapes by his great strength. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance. Despite all its great strength, it cannot save. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. We wait and hope for the Lord, for he is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice. For we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Oh, we look forward to Pastor Collins' sermon on the disruption of Babel, and we rejoice in what we have read in Psalm 33, that the purposes of God are never thwarted or frustrated. Please join with me in prayer. Our Father, we take the time to hallow your name, that your name is set apart and holy, that there is none like you, that no one has ever been your instructor or teacher or counselor, that you are all wise and all knowing and all powerful, and you are always sovereign and always in control. And when you speak, you speak with power and authority and all authority. We thank you that your word is right and true and faithful, and that you are faithful in all that you do. We thank you that you love righteousness and justice. And Lord, we thank you that especially in these times when unrighteousness and injustice seems to flourish and are even applauded, Lord, forgive us for our many sins and our wrong perspectives on what is taking place. Lord, we thank you that you are a God who one day will make everything right. And so, Lord, we look to you for this. Our trust and hope is in you. We thank you that evil will never finally triumph and be victorious. You are the one who foils and thwarts the evil plans of man, the evil plans of this dark world, and the evil plans of spiritual forces in high places. We thank you that your purposes and your plans stand through all generations. We thank you, Lord, because of this, that we see you as our help, and we see you as our shield and protector. You are the one who saves, and we know and acknowledge that we cannot save ourselves, that you are the one who saves us, and you are the one who has sent your son Jesus to die for our sins so that we can be saved and delivered. Thank you, Lord, for your mighty hand in doing all of this. We thank you, Father, for the many reasons we have to gather today to rejoice and to trust and to proclaim you and to rejoice in your great name, in spite of circumstances that surround us. Lord, in spite of chaos and violence, we thank you, Father, for your power for your precious word that will be preached, for the ability and opportunity to sing songs of praise that magnify your great name and sets it apart as holy as it is. And so, Father, we thank you, we praise you for this rich opportunity to meet like this, to rejoice in the technology that we do enjoy, to be able to have this despite the anxiety of not being together, the frustration of not seeing each other in person. Lord, we thank you for what we enjoy despite all of this. And so, Lord, we pray for your power to be demonstrated, that you would continue your work in us, and that you would grow us up and mature us in your Son, Jesus. Again, Lord, we thank you for our government. We praise you, Lord, for those in authority, and we ask you for your help in their lives, that they would promote true wisdom, true godliness, that there would be change of hearts, that you would be the one turning the heart of the king and the rulers of this world. And so, Lord, we pray and ask for these things. Again, we approach you with grateful hearts, anticipating how you will lead us, how you will guide us, how you will teach us through your word today. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
How marvelous! How Good morning. It's good to be with you again today. Would you please open your Bibles with me to Genesis chapter 11, as today we will be reading verses 5 through 9, and as we return once again to the story of the Tower of Babel in the Old Testament. Genesis chapter 11, and we begin reading today in verse 5. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, Behold, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language, so that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. This is our reading of God's Word for today. Let's look to the Lord and ask for His blessing upon it. Our Father in heaven, we do thank You for this day and this time where we can come before Your Word. Lord, we know that Your Word is true, and we know that You have proved Your faithfulness over and over again in generations past. And today we also see Your faithfulness and the truthfulness of Your Word. Lord, we ask today that You would bless us with Your presence, that You would open our hearts and minds by the work of Your Holy Spirit, and that You would teach us today and guide us with Your truth. We ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, just when you thought that your life could not be disrupted anymore than it already has in these past several months, you experienced this past week that we've lived through. And you may be asking yourself, what is going on in the world? What exactly are we living through? Is this going to get worse, or is this going to die out? And is God really in control of all of these circumstances that are at play, that we see all around us? Well, when we ask such questions, of course, we return and look to Scripture. And in God's Word, we find that disruptive events like what we're experiencing today are events that have been repeated throughout the pages of Scripture, that there is nothing new under the sun, and that not only does God allow these events into the world, but God at times uses these events for providential and sovereign purposes. And we see this very thing in Genesis chapter 11, especially in the Tower of Babel, where we see that God brought about a great disruption into the activities of the people living and dwelling in the plain of Shinar. Such a disruption was this, that not only were their languages confused, but their work was disrupted and the people themselves were forced to move away, and you might even say to be socially distanced because of the intervention of God into the activity that they were doing. We see that God brought a great disruption to Babel, and he did it for a very great and sovereign and providential purpose. And so we want to look at that today. In these verses, this is the last half of this section of Scripture, where in the first four verses we have seen the activities of men, what they have decided to do. The children of Adam, the children of man, have settled in this plain and built this great tower and city with the bricks that they've created. But then in verse 5, we see that that's really the hinge point of this section, when God comes down and sees what they've built. And in verses 6 through 9, we then see God's response as God unravels all that these people had done in the plain of Shinar. So first of all, I want you to notice that there is a confrontation. And we see it in verses 5 through 7, as God confronts the sin of man and reveals that man is at fault and that man has been rebellious in his activities in building this city and this tower with its top reaching to the heavens. And so we see in verse 5 that the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. And in Scripture, when we see God coming down, we realize that God is not a God who must come down, but he is a God who at times chooses to come down to see the things that man has done. And this doesn't mean that God couldn't see what they had done in heaven, because Scripture makes it clear that God is everywhere present and he is all-knowing and he is all-powerful. But there are other instances in the Old Testament where we see this phrase that the Lord came down, that Yahweh came down, and we see it particularly in other instances in the ministry of Moses. And when God comes down, God comes down to deliver his word. And we see this in Exodus chapter 19, where in the midst of thunder and lightning and a loud trumpet blast that was so great that the people trembled at the sound of it, that the Lord came down on Mount Sinai in flaming fire and in smoke and in clouds, and the mountain trembled in his presence. And the Lord came down and called Moses up so that the Lord might deliver his word to his people. And so we don't want to slide over a statement like that. This is an amazing statement. God comes down and perhaps even visibly manifested his presence as he did with Moses in a cloud or in smoke, and he delivers his word. We see that in verse 6. And the Lord said, "Behold, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do, and nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them." Here we see in verse 6 that the Lord is explaining and commenting on the nature of sin. And you and I, in our day and age, even now in this present circumstance, we see sin at work in the world. We see how sin can multiply and how it can spread and how in its darkness. It produces so much evil and hostility. It's not behavior that produces peace and love and joy, but it produces division and hatred and all kinds of terrible things. And it has a compounding effect. It's like a snowball rolling down the hill as it grows larger and larger and larger. And if sin is not repented of, if there is no intervention into sin, if God does not intervene, or if someone else does not intervene in our life and confront us, or if we do not feel the conviction of what we're doing and stop what we're doing, sin has an accelerating, multiplying effect. That's something that we are aware of, and as believers in Christ, we still experience this at times. And God, of course, calls us to repent. James chapter 1, verses 13 through 15 describes for us vividly this effect and nature of sin, and how it begins with a temptation, and then how a temptation leads to a desire. And if we allow the desire to conceive within us, it will give birth to sin. And if that sin continues to grow, as James tells us, when it is fully grown, it brings forth death. This is the compounding, increasing effect of sin. And that's why we strive and are called to repent. But imagine a world where everybody speaks the same language and everybody is unified and can easily share their sinful ideas. Imagine how much easier it would be to see sin grow and spread and multiply upon the earth. And soon you would have a world once again like the world was before the flood, when it became so corrupt that there was only one family left that was faithful to God, that God spared through the flood. And so the Lord, when he says nothing will be impossible for them, he's not saying that if he allows this situation to continue as it's going, that eventually it'll reach a point where not even God will be able to stop it. That's not what God's saying. And that's not what Scripture teaches. There's, as Jesus himself says in the Gospel of Matthew, that though there are certain things that are impossible with men, all things are possible with God. God is the creator of heaven and earth. There's nothing that is outside of his sovereign power to restrain or limit or judge or cast into the lake of fire on the final day of judgment, which is reserved for the devil and his angels and all those who reject the truth. What God is commenting here is how this behavior, this accomplishment, is going to embolden these people to think that nothing that they imagine in their minds will be too big or great for them to do, no matter how sinful and evil it may be. And so God intervenes. We see that in verse 7. Come, let us go down, and there confuse their language, so that they may not understand one another's speech. How exactly God did that, we don't know. But we know that there was a time when the world all spoke the same language. And after this event, we see the confusion of languages, the multiplication of languages into the earth. God intervenes. And this is a world, as of yet, that doesn't have translators, because in order to translate a language, you would have to understand it and learn it. And so this is a world of confusion. And God brought this in. It must have been terrifying. It must have felt overwhelming, must have felt frightening. It must have felt like a really bad thing to come perhaps to the job site that day. And now, unlike any other day before, when you want to understand or speak to somebody else, you are confused. And nothing they say makes sense. And because of this great disruption, you're forced to be separated from one another and to move on. But this is an intervention, and really, when we see God intervene with disruptions such as this, whether God directly brings it in to the world, such as this occasion, confusing the languages, or if it's a secondary cause of the fall, whenever God allows a disruption such as this into the world where it is felt by mankind, it is always a call for repentance. It is always a call to turn to God Himself and to confess the truth of what He says that we are, and to confess the truth of what He says that we need and of what He has offered to us. It's always a call to repent. When I was living in California in seminary, I had a small apartment that I shared with two other roommates. And on one occasion, we experienced an intervention of sorts. About 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. in the morning, we would stay up all hours of the night studying, as students do. We heard a knock on the door, and we opened the door, and there were our two weary-eyed landlords that had been pulled out of bed and had come to our apartment because we, as roommates, had parked three cars in our parking lot when we were only allowed two. And another tenant had arrived and wasn't able to park. They called the landlords, and the landlords got out of bed at 2 a.m, drove to our apartment, and told us that we needed to park one of our cars out on the street. Do you think that was a call to repent and to change our behavior? We might have been tempted to look at that and say, well, they were such nice landlords and friendly that they were just being nice to us and we could get away with doing that again or not be so careful. But we knew that if we wanted to continue to live in that apartment complex, that we needed to make sure that we never did that again. Because nobody wants to have their landlord wake up at 2 a.m. and come and confront them at their apartment. So we can relate to that. We've experienced that. And that's something to take note of when we ever experience something like that in our life. But we so often don't think about that in the bigger picture of what God is doing in the world. And we so often go through the world and all the cares of the world only looking at it from earthly perspectives, as if we're asleep, rather than being awakened to the realities of heaven and to be the realities of who God is and allow the truth of His Word to confront us and to expose our need of all that He can provide for us if we'll submit to Him. So we see the confrontation in verses 5 through 7, but notice in verses 7 and 8 that there is also an affirmation. God is affirming that He is God and that He is God alone. God is affirming that He is sovereign over all things, over all the earth, over all of His people. And though mankind so often thinks that they are sovereign over themselves and through their great accomplishments on the earth think that they have no need of God, that they have accomplished all these things through their own efforts, as we are even hearing today, as people are taking credit for the various things that are at work today in the midst of the disruptions that we're experiencing. We have the disruption of the COVID-19 virus. We have the disruption of our economy. And now we have the disruption of rising tensions within our country. rising racial tensions, which is a tragic reality to see and witness, especially when we look at this passage and chapter 10, especially of Genesis, where the biblical writers and the Holy Spirit have explained to us in such a clear way that we are all the same family, and that we have all descended from the three sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. But of course, we are all a fallen family, and sin is present in the world, and it divides us, creates hostility, and does so many terrible things. But how do we respond to these realities? We have to affirm that God is sovereign over all. We have to turn to Him, and that the earth belongs to Him and all the fullness thereof, as Psalm 24, verse 1 tells us, that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein. It all belongs to God. And God has made everything for a purpose, even the wicked, for the day of trouble, Proverbs 16, verse 4. God has a purpose for everything in the world that is still here today. At times we struggle with that as Christians. Why does God allow evil to persist in the world and the wicked at times to prosper when the faithful ones who trust in God at times are suffering? The author of Ecclesiastes reflects on that theme in ancient times. How, as he looks at all the earth under the sun and all the activities of man, he sees that there is a chasing after the wind. There is a crookedness, there is a twistedness to life brought about by the fall that we, through our own efforts, cannot straighten and straighten out. But the Lord, in His wisdom, has determined that we who trust in Him should dwell and live in such a world and in such a presence, even in the midst of the wicked and of evildoers. And certainly Scripture gives us reasons for that. Just as we've read in Proverbs 16:4, the wicked will have a purpose on the day of trouble. And that's why we proclaim the gospel, because we desire that no person would reach that day of trouble when Christ comes again without His redeeming sacrifice. Truth is that God at times calls the wicked to Himself. In fact, we are all wicked apart from the grace of God and the work that He's done in our life. And so, though there is a purpose on that day of judgment where God will display His pure, perfect righteousness and justice in that final judgment day, there's also a sense in which it allows the gospel to shine all the brighter in the present time as it shines as a light in the midst of darkness. So we see that these are some of the reasons why God allows these things to persist. And it reminds us again that all things have a purpose. And it calls us to affirm that the Lord is God and to seek and find the purpose that He has for us, where we are promised that we can please Him if we have faith. But without faith, it is impossible to please God. And God affirms in this sovereign action of intervening in the workings of these people that His word is true, and that He is faithful, and that He is Lord, and that His word will not return to Him empty or void. We have seen in Genesis 9, verse 1, the command of God to Noah and his sons to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. And now we see through this intervention and this restraining of the sinfulness of these people that God brings to pass the fulfillment of his word. And so though this must have been such a challenging, frightening, difficult circumstance to live through, it reminds us that all that God does is good, that his commands are true and pure and powerful and important, and that there is none like God. As Isaiah 46, 9 and 10 says, I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things not yet done. God is not limited in his wisdom and understanding as we are. So in the context of the experience at the Tower of Babel, when they realized their languages were confused, in that context, they were so confused they must not have known, had any idea what was going on. But God's the one who declares the end from the beginning, even in small sense activities such as this, that God knows the end. He knows the purpose of this even from the beginning of it. He knows the far-reaching implications and fruit that would be born through fulfilling this command that he had given for the earth to be filled with people. And likewise, in our present context of these disruptive events that we've talked about, that we're experiencing, just like in the Tower of Babel, when evil is done on the earth, those who do evil are responsible for it. But as we see through the pages of Scripture, God works things together for good, as in the story of Joseph, Genesis 50, and as Paul reflects on in Romans 8, 28, because God sees the end from the beginning, and even in the midst of the present time that we're living, where we are wondering what's going on in the midst of our own confusion, we can trust that God sees the end. He sees the fruit of what he is going to accomplish through these circumstances. And not only that, he sees the fruit that's being produced now. You know, if you and I, all we do is look on and watch the news at this time, all we see is darkness. We see nothing really that's encouraging. And if that's all we see, we can forget and lose sight of the many good and glorious things that God is doing at the present time. This is not meeting this way and worshiping this way and coming before God's word in this way is not what we would ideally want. We want to be able to gather together to worship again. But in ordinary circumstances, this would not be ideal to only meet online. But what an opportunity this is given, not just to us as a local church to have our services broadcast online, but to think about how this is going on all across the world and that the gospel is being proclaimed and promoted in this means. What is the fruit that God is going to produce through this? I have a friend who is a pastor in France who has recently given an update that in a newsletter that their online services have had on certain weeks as many as 4,000 people viewing it. And wow, what a great opportunity that is for the gospel to go out and to bear fruit. So we affirm that the Lord is God and that he is good and that he is still building his church. And he's not limited in understanding as we are. We like to make fun of chickens because we think their brains are so small and say they have pea brains. And we as human beings take pride in that comparison because our brains are so much bigger than theirs. But God still created our brains to fit inside of these heads. And that means that we too are limited We're limited in the size of our brains, the span of our lives, the wisdom that we have to understand and comprehend. And God is not limited at all. So that means that we need to submit to Him. The wise person will listen to Him and submit to Him. We also know that though God has so graciously given us His Word, that within it holds the truth for salvation, the truth that sets us free, that is the light unto our path. We know that God is not limited to the revelation that He has given us even in His Word. But here He communicates to us on a level that we can understand. He is so much greater than we can comprehend. Heaven itself is even greater than we can imagine. And so the wise person affirms that the Lord is God and submits to Him. And then notice in verse 9 that there is also, of course, an anticipation. As God confuses the languages of the people and therefore disrupts their work because they can't understand each other, there is, of course, the immediate benefits, the immediate anticipation of what He's doing through this, and that is that the earth is going to be filled with people. Verse 9, therefore its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. God has graciously restrained their ability to sin by confusing their languages, by limiting their ability to share their sinful ideas with one another. And God has affirmed that He is Lord, and anticipated in this is that certainly, though this would have taken time for the generations to multiply and to spread across the earth, but that as mankind would spread, male and female, husband and wife, as God created them to be in the institution of marriage, that mankind would spread and fill every corner of this globe. And God had a purpose for that. And in a sense, He created the earth to be filled. Genesis 1, verse 2, the earth was without form and void. There's an emptiness in that early created work. But then God fills it with all the beautiful things of creation, all the animals of the earth, the birds in the heavens and the fish of the sea, and the lights and the stars and the sky and the vegetation upon the earth. God fills His creation. And many of the things that He fills it with, first and foremost being man himself, man, male and female created in His image, many of the things that God has filled the earth with were created to be consumed by man, to be ruled over by man, and to be seen by him. Stars in the sky, to see them for signs and seasons and days and for years. And in seeing it, being able to then accomplish their intended purpose and to bring glory to God in so doing. And even though we live in a fallen world, and though we are one big fallen family, there's still a sense in which when this fullness is seen, it allows God to fulfill the fullness of His plan of redemption, and therefore He is glorified and He is honored. Not that there is anything lacking in God, but God is pleased when the things are brought to their appointed end and purpose. And so there's a joy in fullness that I think you and I know and experience. Certain things were created to be filled. And as being created in God's image, I think we as humans, we sense that and we feel it and we know that. And I think we all know what this is like. You know, when you drive away from a gas station, do you feel more joy when your gas tank is empty? Or when you drive away from the gas station and you look at the gas gauge and it's full? There's a certain joy in that. Or if you have eaten a meal or come away from a restaurant and your stomach is empty and you don't feel satisfied, or you come away and you're full and you just had a good meal. There's a sense of joy in that, and there's a sadness when certain things are empty, and there's joy when they're filled. And filling the creation, man sees God's creation and brings him glory. But as we mentioned earlier, and the book of Ecclesiastes makes this clear, there is a brokenness and there's a twistedness to the world in which we live, where at times the things that we desire to be filled are not always filled. And you may have that struggle in your own life. Perhaps you're single and you wish to be married, but you're not yet married. Or perhaps you're married and you wish to have children, but you do not yet have children. At times, that sense of emptiness can fill us with sadness. But that's what drives us and directs us to the gospel, because there is a fullness that's ours in Christ. And Jesus said in John chapter 15, verse 11, "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full." Though we are all citizens and members of this fallen family of the world that is at times twisted and broken, there is a fullness of joy that can be ours in the midst of this world through knowing Christ, because the fallen family that we are all part of is the family descended from Adam, inheriting the sinful consequences of the fall. But Scripture tells us that there is a second Adam who, though through the disobedience of the one man Adam, the many became sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, Jesus Christ, the many can become righteous. That through faith in Jesus Christ, we can be adopted into Christ's redeemed family and have the fullness of joy that is within us, even in the midst of trials and circumstances, that we can learn by his grace to have the same attitude as that of the Apostle Paul, who considered his afflictions as slight and momentary, and as preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. This is the power of the gospel. And we see these far-reaching benefits anticipated also in this work. Because as the world is filled, the world is now stocked with people for Christ and his fishers of men to redeem. And it points us forward to the great, glorious moment in Matthew 28 when Jesus says, "Now all authority in heaven and on earth have been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." We see God advancing the work of redemption through this moment, filling the earth with languages and nations and peoples, anticipating the day of redemption when Christ would provide us with salvation. And anticipating that glorious day that we still await in Revelation chapter 5, where it's recorded, when people from every tribe, nation, language, and tongue will sing, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." What a glorious future this is that we await in Christ Jesus. And so we see there's a divine purpose for this great dispersal of people in Genesis 11. We see that God confronts sin. We see that he affirms that he is God, and his work anticipates a glorious future as man spreads upon the globe, as we see the promises of salvation passed down through the line of Seth, through Abraham, ultimately fulfilled in Christ, as we learn in Galatians 3, verses 8 and 9, anticipating that glorious day. And each step was no doubt frustrating, frightening, and challenging to those who lived through it. And there's also a divine purpose for the present disruption that we are experiencing today, which likewise exposes and confronts sin and calls the world to repent, and which likewise affirms that God is God alone and that He is our only hope for peace and salvation, and that also likewise anticipates the future day of Christ's return, which will be a day of trouble for those who disbelieve, but a glorious day for those who are in Christ. And so this present trial may end soon, and we hope that it will. It might get worse. There might be harder days ahead for you and I. But know this, God will be glorified, and may He be glorified in us. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank You for the great hope that is ours as we come to Your word. It's the hope that lifts our eyes to heaven where Christ is. O Lord, let us fix our eyes on Him. May we know the power of His resurrection. May we know the forgiveness of our sins through faith in Him. May we know what it is to be clothed with His righteousness, and by faith in Him to be justified in Your sight. And may this encourage us and fill us with joy through every day of our life. We ask and pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
I once was lost, but now home for me to walk.